In today's journey, we take a look at inline beer filters and make a big mess, or why our pump videos aren't done yet. And although we'll just be looking at some of the smaller filters today, we have been in talks with a couple companies that are sending us out some samples of the fancier filters. But let's stop with the dilly-dally and get on with it. We have both a Beer Bouncer Classic and a Vac Motion Mini. What's the difference, you ask? Not really anything. And according to the Slipcaster Phil, he's pretty sure they're made from the same mold. And yet this one costs $11.74 extra. And this one is the Vac Motion one. And with the money we saved, we bought some extra filters. And at the end of the day, that's what we were really after anyways. And if you were anything like us, then you probably already are thinking that red filter is not going to filter anything at all. Well, you're in luck, because that's what we're here to test today. Because a visual representation of a filter doesn't really go a long way to tell you what it can do. That's only actually telling you how much light it's blocking. That's why filters are measured in microns, the size of the particle that will be filtered out. Now hold on a moment as we grab our worst case scenario. We got yeast, hops, and oh my god, that's disgusting. I think there might be some fruit chunks and spinach floating around in there too. In other words, a whole bunch of crap I don't want getting all up in the pump. In the red screen, we have a 915 micron filter, and in the blue, we have a 304 micron filter. And before you get excited, neither one or any of the filters we test today are going to be able to filter out yeast. To do that, you would need a 2 micron filter. And that's not really what these are designed to do. What they are designed to do is to remove physical matter that's floating in your beer. Now, a lot of people are brewing weird beers these days, so I don't know what that's going to entail for most people, but ideally these are most after the hops that are floating. In fact, another great use for these would be to put hops inside the filter so that when you're transferring a beer, you can get a little fresh hop flavor, or use it as a randall when you're pouring beer from your kegerator. And if Phil's done fiddling around, we can get this going. Now, worth pointing out that we are using an anti-gravity pump, so it's not the fastest to start with. And this is a worst case scenario. If your beer looks this bad, there's some other things you should be doing first. But a little time distortion and we'll save you the better half of your day. Now, we haven't learned this yet during filming, but those bubbles mean that the filter's full. Also, we don't know it yet, but the Bracken Cane is jammed full of spinach right now. Now, despite our abysmal transfer rate, please note that what is coming out is relatively cleared. And most of what's causing problems should have come out during the cold break, which we didn't do during this brew session. Another problem is that these screens just don't have a lot of surface area. Our limited experience already shows that we really should be using the next size up. Another problem with this worst case scenario testing is testing in serial, one in front of the other, is really not helping us out today. We're going to do a quick redesign of our experiment, but first, let's take a look at what we've caught already in our filters. First, let's start with the blue, because I think that's the one giving us the biggest problem right now anyways. And it doesn't take much to see that, yeah, it's completely clogged. It's hard to shoot up inside these tubes, but you can tell because earlier that you could see light pass through this filter. So, all right, let's take the blue one out and see if we can get it going again, and we can see it does move somewhat, but that red one's probably clogged pretty good too. So it's probably doing more than those Amazon comments give it credit for, but if you're getting clogged this quickly, something else is wrong. Now we're gonna set up for the more reasonable test, but if you're having this kind of problem with your filters, try letting your beer settle for a bit in the brew kettle before transferring it. Or use cold. Cold temperatures will make particles fall out of solution. Or time. Time is what we do. And that's what happened here. So after letting it rest for about 2 to 3 hours, you can see a lot of the sediment just falls out naturally over time without the help of a filter. And it probably would have filtered out a little more by itself, but it's actively fermenting right now. But as you can see, our flow rate is definitely up. But that blue filter is getting clogged again already. And this is pretty good evidence to why Beer Bouncer should use red as the standard filter. For 90% of brewers, red will filter out more than enough for them. And if people want to use blue, that's cool and it's better. But you probably also want to have pre-filtered it with a red first anyways. there are stages to filtration, and sometimes time is in between those phases. Because you can see that this blue screen is getting caked with hop residue and other crud, but it's just not having a good time. I mean, yeah, this is a worst case scenario, but it's also just a gallon. Imagine how much manhandling this would take if I was trying to transfer 5 gallons. We are going to do a more in-depth test on what filter is good at filtering what out specifically, but for now we're seeing how well it works with our pump and just how much we can filter out overall. But now that we're having too much trouble, we're going to switch over to using 2 red filters at the same time and just see how much we can power through what we have here. Don't know why Phil didn't think to clean the first filter out while he was manhandling it a second ago, but we'll get it taken care of. These first look videos are a lot about you learning from our mistakes. And wow, look at all that crud. I'll bet we could filter out the entire ounce of hops that we put into this beer. New video idea, and definitely don't forget to subscribe to check that one out. And you know it's just a matter of time until someone tries to rebrew with those hops. And as you can see, we definitely are having some clogged filters again. Those bubbles are a dead giveaway, and it's about now when Phil's learned about that live, in person, real time. But as you can tell, these red filters definitely do pull out a decent chunk of hop juice. We'll give it one more good cleaning, but we're going to move on to the next phase here. It's good to try to save as much beer as possible, but at the same time, sometimes you have to cut your losses and just accept that you have to leave some behind. Think of the heads and tails when distilling. You don't want 100% of what you're making sometimes. For them, there's medical reasons, but for us, it's mostly just it could be gross or pull off flavors. Speaking of gross, check that out. So today hasn't been just a challenge for the filters, but also the racking can itself. So we're going to cut our losses at this point and clear it out and then do a retransfer back and forth. Don't know why he thought he could get away with not clearing the filters out before transferring back, but we'll use time manipulation again. And it might seem pointless to have to clean a filter since we've already transferred it once. What's it going to filter out a second time? And the issue is the pump. When you use a pump to forcibly move a liquid through a filter, when it gets full, it can actually forcibly move things through the screen that would normally be withheld. In an autosiphon, you would just lose suction. And wow, look at that night and day versus before. We're getting back to just under a gallon a minute, which is about the target for our pump that we're using. And this time, the left filter didn't really do much, all of the crud was held in the one on the right. And it stands out pretty noticeably because the left filter, you can see the screen, whereas the right filter, it's completely greened out. Although that's not to say that nothing went into the second filter. Although it looked more like stringy fruit particles than hop residue when we opened it up. But now that we've made a mess, let's clean this all up so that we can make another mess. And one might say that this looks suspiciously like the original setup, but notice there's no chunks of floating banana or other weirdness floating around. At this point, it's all rehydrating yeast particles and an abundance of sugar. And we almost get to the end of the transfer, but we have to do one cleaner out, and it's mostly just hop residue still. I was kind of expecting that because at 1 ounce per gallon, that's a lot of hops. So it makes sense that there's a decent chunk to filter out still. But had these been the size up, we definitely would have been able to power through this because we'd have twice the amount of screen size for the filter. If you were looking at buying a filter and you were a real big hophead, I'd say go a size up from what you think you need. But now that Phil has some experience, you can see he's starting with the filter on the right. And this time we're expecting nothing at all in the red filter because the blue filter should be filtering out anything that will get stuck in the red filter. And if you've been mindful of your brewing process until now, this is about what you should see inside the blue. It's just a fine coating of green powder, basically. So yeah, it does do a decent job at filtering, but for the most part, it's doing more than what most people would need. So it does make sense as an add-on accessory, or at least not as your primary filter. But if you're like us and you like to take things too far, we have the white filter. Now, this will remove stuff that you can't really see inside the beer, but it's also stuff that'll just fall out of solution during fermentation. And something I was only able to buy from Vac Motion was this black filter at 40 microns. Now, that sounds really extreme, but keep in mind that a sterile filter that's used in the industry is about half a micron, and some can be even smaller. That's where you would need to be at to filter out yeast. So you can use these inline filters and carbonate in the bottle with your yeast. And here we go. And one of the things that I was the most worried about during this was the pump not being able to handle some of these tighter microns. And it was definitely able to. We did see a flow rate hit, but we didn't see the pump overheating or struggling or making loud noises, or at least different loud noises than it usually makes. But here come those telltale bubbles that the filter is clogged already. And of course, it's much of the same, just smaller particles and a tighter filter. I can see this being useful for something that you're trying to keep really clear, like a lager. But if you were going to dry hop this beer anyways, I find it's kind of a waste of time. Much like how Phil just wasted all that beer, not realizing that the siphon still works, even when you're not using a siphon. But let's hurry through this part so that we can see what's actually coming out of the filters. And do keep in mind that this isn't completely evident of what your experience would be with these products. We're just doing something stupid so that you don't have to. But we don't want to cause any confusion that we do really like these filters, and we will probably use these in some sort of fashion in every brew moving forward. Whether it be that we're actually trying to filter something out of the beer itself, or just using them as pre-filters for our pump to keep it safe. Inline beer filters is something we'd recommend for almost every brewer, but only to somebody that's having a problem that needs to be solved. Because this small amount of particles being filtered out is actually solvable other ways too. Irish Moss and Whirlflock tablets, just to name two. And if those two products were completely perfect, then no professional brewer would ever need to use anything else. So like almost all brewing equipment, there's a time and a place. But we would recommend most people to start with using the larger size filters. At Vac Motion, they call them regular, and at Beer Bouncer, they call them Mac Daddy, or MD. And unless your goal is perfection, then the black filter is way overkill. Yes, it's filtering things, but is it making a big difference? Should you be using something actually way smaller? Like we said earlier, professional brewing usually uses filters that are like half a micron. Those are called sterile filters, and the point of those is to remove bacteria so that when beer sits on a shelf for a long time, you don't have to worry about it getting infected. And that's part of what makes professional beer shelf stable and keeps that homebrew flavor in homebrew. The biggest issue I have with these filters is using them later in fermentation. After there's alcohol involved, I don't really like the idea of aeration. You can flood it with CO2. I've seen it. We'll probably do it in the future. You could use these with a vacuum pump, and that'll get rid of the oxygen before the beer goes in. But I kind of really like these for brew day filters. That's where they really shine. And they can actually help with aeration a bit. You can see right now, Phil's actually pumping it out from and back into the same vessel and just running the liquid through the filters. As long as you're practicing good sanitation, there's really no harm in it. That does come back to another one of its negatives, though, is it is a lot more surface area to make sure it's clean. That's why we prefer to use a hop screen that sits inside of the brew pot, because then it boils with it. But no method is perfect, like we mentioned before, and hops aren't the only thing we're actually filtering out on brew day. So actually, I can see them working in tandem really well. And if there's a suggestion of something you'd like us to test, let us know down in the comments. But unfortunately, the one thing these filters were unable to take out was the abundance of sugar that was in there. But don't worry, a couple days later, the yeast took care of most of it. This was just a first look and us just having fun with the filters overall. Seeing what they can, can't do, and how well they'll work with our pump. But don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, because we will be having another video coming up soon where we're working with some of these companies to make more content.